conviction in our hearts, crying out to the heavens on the plains of Arafat, standing proud beside my brother, silent at Muzdalifa.
Nahmaduhu wa nusalli ala rasulihil kareem. Amma ba'd. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I welcome all the viewers of Peace TV for this unique series of interviews wherein we invite scholars of Islam, du'ats, students of knowledge and experts in the field of the Quran and the Sunnah to come and share with us the beautiful facets of Islam and its teachings, as well as help us to overcome the challenges that which we Muslims face as individuals and communities all across the globe. In the past 6 episodes, alhamdulillah, we have been dealing with a very interesting and a beautiful series on the topic of the virtues of the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And to share knowledge about this wonderful topic, we have with us in the studios our dear Sheikh Dr. Haytham Al-Haddad. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi, Sheikh.
Assalamu rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khairan for coming and sharing your knowledge about this topic. Sheikh, alhamdulillah, in the past 6 episodes, we learned many things related to the virtues of Dhul Hijjah, as well as those issues that which are associated or which are closely linked with the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. Today, inshallah, we would like to ask you, or coming to the main topic of the series, that is, our viewers would like to know what exactly are the virtues of these first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. In fact, there are a number of Quranic verses, a number of statements by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also, in fact, we find the number of statements by the early scholars that talk about the virtues of these 10 days. In fact, there is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith Jabir, which many scholars classify as an authentic hadith, that the best days of the dunya are the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah.
Subhanallah.
The best days of the dunya, afdalu ayyami dunya, are the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And that's why the scholars discussed a very important issue. They said the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are better than the last 10 days of Ramadan, because when you know the last 10 days of Ramadan and the virtues of the last 10 days of Ramadan, and the last 10 days of Ramadan, they include Laylatul Qadr.
Definitely, which is better than the 1,000 months, as Allah says in the Quran.
Yes, Laylatul Qadr khayrun min alfi shahr. And Allah Jalla wa Ala revealed the Quran in Layla Mubarakah. What is the Layla Mubarakah? Hamim wal Kitab al Mubin in anzalnahu fi Laylatul Mubarakah. Inna kunna mundhirin. What is Layla Mubarakah?
It's nothing but the Laylatul Qadr.
And in general, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to observe i'tikaf in the last 10 days of Ramadan, and he used to shadd al-mi'zar, as Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said that he would tighten his lower garment, which means either he used to work hard or he never had any sexual relationship with his wife. Also, we know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam used to observe Qiyamul Layl and used to stay awake for the entire night.
And also awake his family members as well.
And he used to wake up his family members. So how come the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are better than the last 10 days of Ramadan? Now, the hadith in general may lead to this. And this hadith, as we said, some scholars believe that it is an authentic hadith. So the scholars were comparing between the hadith that speak about the virtues of the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah and the hadith that talk about the virtues of the last 10 days of Ramadan. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala and a number of other scholars as well came up with a conclusion. They said, as for the days, the daytime, the days of Dhul Hijjah are the best.
Okay.
Throughout the year. And the nights of Ramadan are better than the nights of the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah.
MashaAllah.
And this is a good conclusion. Anyway, I don't want the brothers and sisters to argue over this issue and to dig more into it. This is the conclusion. Some scholars believe that the last 10 days of Ramadan are the best. Some scholars believe that the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are the best. Ibn Taymiyyah believe that the last 10 nights of Ramadan are best than the first 10 nights of Dhul Hijjah, and the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are better than the last 10 days of Ramadan.
10 days of Ramadan.
The last 10 days of Ramadan.
Basically, both these 10 days are, mashallah, the best.
Are very virtuous. This is the issue. Very virtuous. To the level that Abu Thabit al-Bunani, one of the scholars from the second generation, he used to say that the Salaf used to glorify and pay attention to three tens.
Subhanallah.
Three tens. The last 10 days of Ramadan, the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, and there are other 10 days that people, unfortunately, don't pay that much attention to, which is the first 10 days of Muharram.
Subhanallah.
You know, the scholars said, in general, what are the best of the months? Ramadan. After that is Dhul Hijjah.
Dhul Hijjah.
After that is Muharram.
The month of Allah.
The month of Muharram. Some other scholars looked at it in a different way. They said each month has its own virtues, and more ibadat are more virtuous in that particular month than other months. So, for example, they said Ramadan is the best of months in general, which is the ninth
month of the
Hijra calendar. And after that, in terms of fasting in Muharram. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, أَفْضَلُ الصِّيَامِ بَعْدَ صِيَامِ رَمَضَانِ fasting in Muharram, the best of fast. After fasting, the month of Ramadan is fasting during Muharram.
Muharram.
And some scholars said, even if you fast the entire month of Muharram, do it. So this is in terms of fasting in general. But they said that Dhul Hijjah in particular, the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are better than the month of Muharram. And the activities in Dhul Hijjah are a little bit different from the activities during the month of Muharram. Why? Because we have the Hajj, and we have the Udhiyah, and we have some other particular activities. So they looked at it from different angles, but it seems that in general, the best of months follows this order: Ramadan, then Dhul Hijjah, then Muharram. Interestingly to know is that some scholars said that Allah Jalla wa Ala likes the third part of each period. So he said, if we look at the night, Allah Jalla wa Ala likes the third part of the night, the last third, of the night. Okay? In terms of Ramadan, Allah Jalla wa Ala likes the third part of Ramadan, the last third of Ramadan.
That's right.
Yeah, the first 10 days, the second 10 days,
and the,
third 10 days. Okay, the last 10 days. In terms of the entire year, Allah Jalla wa Ala likes the third part of the year. If we say that the year includes 12 months,
yes,
4, 4, 4. The last 4 months in the entire year is Ramadan,
Shawwal,
Dhul-Qa'dah,
Dhul-Hijjah. MashaAllah.
And they said the last part of the year includes what? Includes the most virtuous months.
MashaAllah.
Ramadan and Dhul-Hijjah. Moreover, the month of, as we know, the month of Dhul-Qa'dah, Dhul-Hijjah, followed by the month of Muharram, are considered to be from al-ashhur al-hurum.
MashaAllah.
And that shows that the month of al-hajj, yad al-hijjah, which is the 12th, lies in the middle of this discussion around the virtuous days, the virtuous months. And this, if we look at many other ahadith and statements by the scholars, confirm. We will see that those ahadith, those statements, confirm the status of the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah For example, Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Al-Fajr, this is well known for all of us, وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ. This is an oath. Allah Jalla wa Ala has the right to swear by anything, to swear an oath by anything he likes. We as a human beings, we have no right except to have an oath by Allah Jalla wa Ala. Yes, we cannot make an oath even by Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We cannot say wa Muhammad. But Allah Jalla wa Ala has the right to make an oath by anything of his creation. He's all the Lord, he's creation. The creator, he's the supreme being, and all of the creation is his.
That's true.
Okay? So Allah Jalla wa Ala said by Fajr. Al-Fajr is the dawn. Wa layalin ashr, what are the layalin ashr?
Inshallah, we will discuss this, Shaykh. What do we mean by the wa layalin ashr, the oath that which Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has taken in Surah Al-Fajr, but after a short break.
Crying out on the plains of Arafat.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Shaykh, before the break we were discussing about the oath that which Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has taken in Surah Al-Fajr.
Yes. So this oath, Allah Jalla wa Ala said, وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَانٍ عَشَرٍ. The scholar said, when Allah Jalla wa Ala swears by anything, it means that Allah Jalla wa Ala loves that. Allah Jalla wa Ala glorifies that. Because the oath is, you don't make an oath by anything. You make an oath by something magnificent.
Yes.
Something glorified in your eyes. That's why we cannot glorify other than Allah, or the most to be glorified in our eyes as a human beings is our creator, Allah Jalla wa Ala.
That's true. Subhanallah.
But from the other side, Allah Jalla wa Ala, there is no greater than Allah. Yes, and Allah Jalla wa Ala is different from us.
He's the greatest.
He's the greatest, and he has the right to do whatever he wants. لا يسألوا عما يفعل وهم يسألون. No one can question Allah Jalla wa Ala of what he wants. And all of us are his creation. So when he makes an oath by something, it means that that thing has a special love. Or that it means that Allah Jalla wa Ala loves that thing or gives some attention to that thing. Or he wants us to pay more attention to that what Allah Jalla wa Ala swears with, okay? For example, when we see that Allah Jalla wa Ala swears an oath by وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَاهَا, all these are great creatures of Allah Jalla wa Ala.
Definitely.
And Allah Jalla wa Ala wants us to pay attention to these things. وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ. See, وَالْعَصْرِ, by the time. So here, when Allah Jalla wa Ala swore an oath by Layalin Ashr, it means that those are significant nights. What are those nights? Most of the Mufassirin, or many of the Mufassirin, the scholars who explain the Quran, they say these are the nights of the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. Yeah, Mujahid, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, the students of Ibn Abbas, the famous interpreters of the Quran. We know that Ibn Abbas is the most famous.
The Tarjuman al-Quran.
Tarjuman al-Quran, and the Prophet ﷺ made dua for him. His students were among the best to give explanation to the Quran. Mujahid said that I read the Quran 3 times with Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Every time I ask him about every single ayah in the Quran.
Subhanallah.
So Sa'id ibn Jubayr, one of the students of Ibn Abbas, he was killed by Al-Hajjaj anyway. He was a very righteous person, and he stood against the tyranny of Al-Hajjaj. Anyway, Sa'id ibn Jubayr said that Layalin Ashr means the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. In fact, Al-Tabari, rahimahullah ta'ala, the great mufassir, he said there is a consensus.
Subhanallah.
Yeah, there is a consensus that Layalin Ashr are the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. There is another view, to be honest with you, that Layalin Ashr refer to the 10 days of Ramadan, the last 10 days of Ramadan. It is a view, it is not endorsed by many scholars, but it is there. We have to confirm that it is there. Okay, just before we move from this point, I'm sure the audience will ask a question. Why Allah Jalla wa Ala said, وَلَيَالٍ, He didn't say, وَأَيَّامٍ. Because they might say, well, this supports the other opinion that those layali
are the last 10 nights of Ramadan.
The last 10 nights of Ramadan. They refer to the night of Ramadan.
This could be one of the conclusions at which we can make.
It is interesting, as we mentioned this, it is interesting to know that in Arabic language, it is a habit of the Arabs to mention the night referring to the day.
Okay.
As if the night is more important than the day. So when they talk about the night, they mean that the day is included. This reminds me with the hotels. The hotels count on nights. They don't count on days.
On the days.
Maybe because of the people need to stay somewhere in the night. So they look at the most important part of the day. Maybe for us as Muslims, because the night is, we do Qiyam al-Layl, we go and we rest in our houses. And as Allah Jalla wa'ala says, He made the Nahar Ma'ash and the Layl Subat. Yeah, Subat is a place where we go back to our homes, families, and then we establish the Dhikr and the Ibadah. Maybe, Allahu A'lam. But, you know, as we are talking about the nights and the days, it was reported that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to fast the three nights. Like this in number of a hadith, the three nights. Yeah?
Okay.
The three white nights. Sah?
Yes.
The three white. Al-Ayyam al-Bid.
Ayyam al-Bid.
Or Al-Ayyal al-Bid. Because they said Bid, why are they Bid? Because the moon will be full in 13, 14 and 15.
15.
So they were talking about the nights of the days. The nights of the day. But we fast in the days.
Of course.
But they referred to the days by their nights.
That's
the nights are white because the moon is full in these nights. Anyway, so it is clear. So this is the opinion of many scholars who gave tafsir of the Quran, that walayalin ashr, it refers to the first 10 days of the Hijjah. However, the other opinion is there. Sa'id ibn Jubayr, who narrated this, or who endorsed this opinion, they said that he used to do a lot of ibadah in these nights, in fact, as if he was not sleeping during these nights. And he used to say, don't put off your lights in these nights.
Allahu Akbar.
La tutfi'u surujakum. Yeah? Keep the lights on. And he said, wake up your servants to make sahur for the day of Arafah because of the virtues of these nights. And the scholar said that because of the status of those days, Islam encouraged us to do number of ibadat, and we will discuss them. But one of the pillars of al-Islam is performed when?
During the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah.
Is performed during the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And most of the Hajj is completed when?
In the month of Dhul Hijjah.
In the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. Not only in the month. It is in the month. The month is very virtuous. But the most virtuous part of the month is the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah.
Then we have the Ayyam al-Tashriq.
Yawm Arafah and Yawm al-Eid. Most of the activities of al-Hajj are done in those 2 days.
That's right.
Which are the most virtuous days of the entire month, and according to some scholars, they are the most virtuous days of the entire year. Inshallah, we'll come and discuss that. Again, as we are talking about the virtues of the first 10 days of the Hijjah, we read two authentic ahadith that confirm that doing ibadat is the most virtuous during these
10 days.
10 days. There are two ahadith that we need to memorize.
Inshallah.
The first one is Hadith Abdullah ibn Abbas. And this Hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. Yeah? And al-Bukhari, rahimahullahu ta'ala, he wrote a chapter. Bab Fadlul Amali fi Ayyam al-Ashr. Chapter of the virtues of doing good deeds during the first 10 days of the Hijjah. And he included Hadith ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam said, ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيهن أحب إلى الله منه في هذه الأيام. قالوا ولا الجهاد في سبيل الله يا رسول الله؟ قال ولا الجهاد في سبيل الله إلا أن يكون الرجل خرج بماله ونفسه فلم يرجع من ذلك بشيء. The translation of this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there are no days. Or to have an accurate translation, because we need to differentiate between this hadith and hadith ibn Umar, the one that we will mention inshallah. Here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ma min ayyamin al-amalu salih. There are no days in which the good deeds are more beloved to Allah jalla wa ala than those 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. Than those 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. They said, even Ya Rasulullah, even going for jihad means doing good deeds on those 10 days of Dhul Hijjah will be better than going for jihad, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet ﷺ said, yes, it will be better than going for jihad, except for a mujahid, for a person who went for jihad by his life and his wealth. So he lost both. He lost both. He lost his life and he lost his entire wealth that he took for jihad. So that person, because he sacrificed everything, obviously he has the highest level of good deeds. He sacrificed the most virtuous thing for him, which is his life. And obviously he sacrificed his wealth as well. So that is a special person. He has the highest level of status. He is better than those who do good deeds in the last or in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. Other than that, doing good deeds. And that's why we need really to encourage our brothers and sisters and ourselves. Doing good deeds in those 10 days is more virtuous than jihad in general.
Jazakallahu khairan, Shaykh. MashaAllah. Our audiences must have known that the only thing that which can be equal in sawab with doing good deeds in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah is a person doing jihad, spending his wealth and expending his life and does not return with anything. MashaAllah. Jazakallahu khairan, Shaykh. We will discuss more of the virtues of the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah in our next or the coming episodes. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.